of course, on this beautiful spring day. And welcome to the choir behind me, back for the first time in a long, long time. And of course, everyone is welcome back on March 20th, masked and socially distanced, but welcome back. And welcome, of course, no matter what you believe. Welcome no matter what you do not believe. Welcome no matter what you have done. And welcome no matter what you have left undone. Welcome no matter who you are. And welcome no matter who you love. Because this is not just the Church of Trinity-St. Paul's Center for Faith, Justice, and the Arts, nor is it only the Church of the United Church of Canada. This is, in fact, the Church of Christ. And in Christ's Church, everyone, everyone is welcome. I'd invite you all at home to pray with us. Let us pray together. Divine One, Creator, source of all love, the one who knows us better than we know ourselves, the one who is closer than our own breath, the one who surrounds us with light and leads us into light, the one who smooths the path for us in this Lenten season, the one who journeys with us, we follow and are accompanied. That one. We ask that you be with us during this worship, that you be with us in life, and that you uphold us, and that you strengthen us, as Christ did. Amen. The light of Christ, it is the light of our world. We have a number of announcements today. First of all, the anti-racism group is meeting tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, and with a special report from our own James Mackey at the back, who testified before the police board. So we're looking forward to hearing from him. Also, this Wednesday, our prayer group meets again, and the subject matter is presence. By the way, all of our meetings are in Zoom, so just check our website, you'll find the link there. And of course, importantly, next week is the annual general meeting, and that happens right after church, a little bit of a break so you can get coffee and a sandwich, and then come back. And that's, by the way, spring forward weekend, I believe, so don't let that throw you off. Also, all through March in Children's Church, thank you, Douglas, it's Monster Madness. So if you know some kids, again on Zoom, who want to have some fun, please join in. And again, information readily available. Finally, today, as you can see, we are celebrating Holy Communion. So for you at home, what does that mean? It means, absolutely, it's noon somewhere in the world. So if you want wine, go for it. If you're just drinking coffee, know that it's holy if we bless it and if we share it together. The same with whatever food you have, toast, crackers, whatever. Today we're using tortillas. So please, anything that gives you sustenance, anything that strengthens you, anything that gives you joy, that's holy. And we'll share it together, which is what makes it even holier. We always acknowledge that we are on traditional territory here at Trinity-St. Paul's. Today is no exception of that. Sometimes when we say the same words, we don't hear them anymore. So please listen, and I would invite you to think in this era that not only Ukrainians are defending their land, but so are the Wet'suwet'en on the west coast of Canada, and so are Grassy Narrows and many other First Nations people where incursions onto their traditional lands are happening. So please hold them in prayer as we say these words. As we assemble in this holy place, we recognize that for thousands of years, this territory has been a sacred gathering place for many peoples of Turtle Island. We respectfully acknowledge that we are on the traditional territory of several Indigenous nations and wish to pay special recognition to the Mississaugas of the Credit. The original nations continue to cry out for justice. And together we say, as treaty people, we commit to listen, learn, and work to right the wrongs of the past and present. Passing of the peace is a tradition that's gone on for 2,000 years, plus some. And we're going to continue it today as we do every Sunday. If you are at home, put yourself on gallery mode so you can see all the beautiful faces of the people that are worshiping with us. And of course, share it with each other. If you're at home with somebody you care about, by all means, hug, kiss, whatever, dance around the room. And here we can do this, we can do this, we can do this, we can blow kisses, we can have some fun. And I start it all off by saying, the peace of Christ be with you.
When you have come into the land that the Lord your God is giving you as an inheritance to possess, and you possess it and settle in it, you shall take some of the first of all the fruit of the ground, which you harvest from the land that the Lord your God is giving you. And you shall put it in a basket and go to the place that the Lord your God will choose as a dwelling for his name. You shall go to the priest who is in office at that time and say to him, "Today I declare to the Lord your God that I have come into the land that the Lord swore to our ancestors to give us." When the priest takes the basket from your hand and sets it down before the altar of the Lord your God, you shall make this response before God: "A wandering Aramean was my ancestor. He went down into Egypt and lived there as an alien, few in number. And there he became a great nation, mighty and populous. When the Egyptians treated us harshly and afflicted us by imposing hard labor on us, we cried to the Lord, the God of our ancestors. God heard our voice and saw our affliction, our toil, and our oppression. God brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, with a terrifying display of power, and with signs and wonders. And God brought us into this place and gave us this land, a land flowing with milk and honey. So now I bring the first fruit of the ground that you, O Lord, have given me. You shall set it down before the Lord your God and bow down before God. Then you, together with the Levites and the aliens who reside among you, shall celebrate with all the bounty that God has given to you and to your house." Herein is wisdom.
God be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to God.
from Luke. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing, and when these days were over, he was famished. The devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." Jesus answered him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone."
Dear friends, we are going to Jerusalem with Jesus. Jesus is our pardon, our healing, and our peace. We will suffer the trial and we will resist evil with Jesus. We are ready for the journey. We are ready to be changed by the journey.
Then the devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And the devil said to him, "To you I will give their glory and all this authority, for it has been given over to me, and I give it to anyone I please. If you then will worship me, it will all be yours." Jesus answered him, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him."
I'd invite you to pray with me. Let us pray. Dearest God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our strength and our Redeemer. What a time we live in. The pandemic has become an endemic. Shells, as we speak, are falling even on churches in Ukraine. In Yemen, some 37 strikes are happening almost on a daily basis. In Somalia, more. Iraq and Syria are hardly at peace. Here in our own country, First Nations struggle for their land, and everywhere, poverty exists. It's really tempting to start thinking about scarcity. It's really tempting not to recognize the abundance of this incredible creation and what God has given us. If we just look to Deuteronomy and the first fruits passages, or to Genesis, we'll see that we live in incredible bounty, but we don't share it. Why don't we share it? Because spiritually speaking, in this Lenten season, we recognize fear in ourselves, the fear of potential scarcity. It makes us afraid to share. It holds back our generosity. For this Lenten journey, give up the theology of scarcity and embrace the theology of abundance. You know, we have over 3 people a week that are dying of hypothermia and other diseases on the streets of this city, Toronto, one of the wealthiest cities in the world. And yet we hoard. We hoard. The other S word that I invite you to think about is sanctuary, because after all, we don't need to worship here. We don't need to gather around this table. We don't need to be members of a faith community. We could Netflix and chill. We could go for brunch. We could sleep in. But we come to places like this for a reason, because here we model what the promised land might look like. As I've said before, we don't have to like everyone here, but we do have to love them. And that takes some learning. And faith communities are the only places where the mission is about learning to love the Creator, the Divine, and to love each other. Every other organization you're with has another mission statement. This is our purpose for being. This is sanctuary. This is what sanctuary means, a safe place. I remember back in 9/11 when in my church then we kept the sanctuary open all night long because we didn't know what was going to happen. We didn't know if that was the beginning of the Third World War. And I imagine now in Ukraine, in the churches as we speak, they are places of refuge for people to go in to pray, even if they might be shelled. These are still places of holiness, of refuge, of sanctuary. We live in trying times, and this community and even this building are places of refuge. Might we know them as such? Might we know them? And might we know sanctuary? And so with all the angels, we say, holy, holy, holy God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of God. Jesus confounded the mighty and gave hope to the humble. Jesus was betrayed and deserted. Jesus died between thieves and was buried in a borrowed grave. Even on the night of betrayal, Jesus ate supper with friends.
Then the devil took Jesus to Jerusalem and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to protect you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. Jesus answered him, it is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished every test, he departed from him until an opportune time.
Another temptation, the temptation that we are not essential, the temptation to believe that we are not loved, the temptation to believe that we are alone, and the temptation to believe that we are not made in the image of the divine. Let's, in this journey through Lent, get rid of those temptations to see us as anything less than beloved. It's interesting in this passage that Sean just read that the devil quotes scripture, and yet we know in our lives and in the news that happens frequently. Today, because we're entering into the week of women, of International Women's Day and the month of women's rights. And I think and pray for those who call themselves Christian in Texas and Florida, where they're restricting women's control over their own bodies. And they're using scripture. They're using scripture to do it. We can think of other places too where the devil quotes scripture. Because we know, for example, in the war zone of Ukraine, that both sides claim to be Christian, and both sides are praying as we speak for success somewhere for their sides. Please follow Jesus in this Lenten path. Do not follow the devil. Church and we all are not magicians. This is not a magic act, this table. This is a holy table. It is a sacred table. And it's a sacred table because everyone is welcome around it. Judas to Jesus, everyone is welcome around this table. Around this table, there is no enemy. There is only those beloved and those who wander from the path. Bring them back with love. Bring them back knowing that they are graced. Bring them back around the table by our generosity and our faithfulness. Please do not use scripture in order to diminish another. Do not use scripture that way. With hearts full of joy, we come giving thanks to our Creator and offering our praise. It is right to give God thanks and praise. Jesus confounded the mighty and gave hope to the humble. Jesus was betrayed and deserted. Jesus died between thieves and was buried in a borrowed grave. Even on the night of betrayal, Jesus ate supper with friends, and one of those friends was Judas. The bread of life. Holy Spirit, come, make all things new. Bless this bread and let it become the bread of life. The cup of salvation. Bless also this cup. Let it become the cup of salvation. Come now, for all things are ready. And I invite you at home to partake now in what you have that's become your holy communion. And together we say, Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Another temptation is to believe that war is inevitable, that war will always be because it's always been. I suggest that on this walk during Lent, we imagine a new way of being. We imagine a promised land where that is not the case. And we certainly know that the response to war is not to invest in more armaments. More armaments lead to more war. How? How do we walk the way of peace? We walk the way of peace by giving people a land that they feel worthy and accepted enough to defend. And that means giving people a place to live, enough food to eat, health care that they need, the education that we all need. That means recognizing the land rights of our First Nations. That means recognizing the dignity of every single human being. And that means taking the money from war and putting it in to those aspects of our lives that lead to peace. That's what walking the way of peace means. And also, of course, what it doesn't mean is investing in more pipelines as you're out there feeling sticker shock at the gas pumps, know this. The answer to the problem of being held hostage for fossil fuels is not more fossil fuels. It is to move to renewables and to move to a world where we do not need them, that we can't be bribed by them or betrayed by them. That is what is necessary to walk the path of peace. And remember, there is no peace without justice. And so walking the way of peace means to walk a just path. It means to look out for everyone. It means equal rights. It means equal rights for everyone. And again, this leads back to generosity. It leads back to knowing that our neighbor is part of our family, and that around this table sits only family, and that is the world. There is no one left out. So it doesn't stop at our borders. It doesn't stop at our oceans. It contains the world. Those are brothers, sisters, and others. This is the walk of peace. And of course, we recognize that those who are in war zones right now, we pray for them. We pray light around them and love around them. We pray for every refugee from every place. We pray a world without refugees, and a place and a world where all refugees are accepted, given home, given food, given family. So let us pray. May this cup and this bread give us life, even life everlasting, for love that never dies, for a peace beyond our understanding, for the joy of true communion. In Christ's name, amen. In this sanctuary, we need your help. We need our entire community to keep this place going as a beacon of light and peace and hope and joy and, of course, love. And to do that, we need your support. It's very easy to do that. You just go to our website and you donate, knowing that this place will then be a refuge and a sanctuary and a place of peace for the next generation and the next generation and the generation after that. We commit ourselves to justice, peace, and love. We share in this community of Trinity-St. Paul's United Church, and do so with generosity and gratitude, for we are blessed. Blessings we pledge to share with your world. Let us take a moment of quiet reflection. And together we say, Divine One, accept our gifts for the life and ministry of this your church. They are given with thanksgiving for your work in the world.
Let us pray. Creator God, today, in this hour, devoted to worship you as the source of love, life, and good relationships. Today, in this hour, when we listen and sing music that transcends us, share a ritual meal that connects us in memory of Jesus, listen to words that inspire us, today we also lament and fear. Today, as we hear more birdsong, as we are aware of the lengthening of days, as the ice and snow are melting and spring is in the air, as children are born, art is created, dialogues are started and friends can start gathering again in person, today our hearts are breaking. The temptation to exert power over others, fed by fear and paranoia, has created a global movement of intolerance and entitlement, culminating in the unleashing of death, wounding, maiming, and utter destruction of infrastructure in the Ukraine. Today, our hearts are breaking with a new awareness of the depth of our own biases. I, for one, have to admit I distanced myself from the suffering of non-white peoples in, for instance, sub-Saharan regions, where millions have suffered atrocities and displacement for decades. And there is a new awareness that people of color and indigenous peoples would have been given much less leeway in protests than the people involved in the trucker convoy. God of life and love, we are grateful for our ability to keep questioning ourselves and to feel compassion. God of love, help us resist evil. Speak to us now in the silence of our hearts. God, hear our prayers, and in your love, answer. Source of love, we pray for people and places who are affected by war and loss. Loss of loved ones, loss of security and peace, loss of health, loss of joy. We name them now, silently or aloud. In our own community, we pray for the family and friends of Reverend Margaret Taylor, who was the twin sister of Ella Taylor Walsh, the family of Kenneth Bagnall, Shannon Cottrell, Bill Phibbs, Satinder Singh, Tony Wise, Jackie McKinley, Fova, Jill McKechnie and Emma Sarkese, Lee Potts, Dan Beckett, Andreas Prinz, Sayar Said, Mary Marshall, Judy Bonner, and all those in our community affected by COVID-19. And we pray for these churches in the Shining Waters Regional Council, the Hungarian United Church of Toronto, Stuart Memorial United Church in Lake of Bays, St. Andrew's United Church in Toronto, and St. Paul's United Church in Brampton. Holy God, speak to us now in the silence of our hearts. And in your love, answer. God of love and peace, in this time of Lent too, we thank you for life and love, for the potential to grow, to learn, to care, and create those things that sustain and nurture, also and especially in the face of evil. Help us find your peace. The ecumenical prayer with the churches of Ireland and the UK is about this finding of peace in the wilderness. Let's say it now together. God of passion and power, insistent, immediate, challenging, compelling us with your story's breathless beginning, walk us into the wilderness to hear your voice where silence reigns. Give us insight, the vision beyond all seeing, so we may look upon heavens torn open and know that the time of good news for all creation is always now. Amen.
thank you for being with us.
And I particularly want to thank Courtney and James and Aaron, who hold it down at the back and keep the sound rolling. And of course, today, to our entire choir, give yourselves a hand. I mean, it's wonderful to have you here. So yeah, come on. Yes. I'm sure they are at home. And know this, the walk of Lent is not a walk of suffering, it is a walk of salvation. And know this, that around this world, people are rising up for peace. Oh my goodness, across Russia, across Ukraine, across the rest of the world, the vast majority of God's creatures demand and pray for peace. Be one of them. And know that if you are one of them, that you never, ever walk alone. But God, the source of all love, Jesus Christ, who is love incarnate, and the Holy Spirit, love's power, walks with you now and walks with you always.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Hi.
And I wanted to say happy birthday to Marianne. I don't know if she... Hi, Marianne.
Marianne Pope.
Yes, Marianne yeah. Pope. Yeah. I heard it was your birthday. Mm. That's lovely.
Hi, Carola. How is Germany?
Hey, nice. It's just like 16:30 is a weird time to join because usually we go for walks on like Sunday afternoons. So it's really hard for me to be home on time for service.
Yeah.
Nice to see you.
Yeah. How's your new job?
It's really nice. It's a bit stressful at the moment because there's so much to learn, but it's really nice and it's very close to my place. So it's nice. Yeah. But everybody's still working from home. So I'm mainly alone.